Hi there, physics fans. Over the last dozen episodes, we've talked about all sorts of things that occur in the subatomic realm. But the world of the ultra-small is not the only interesting domain to study. There's also the big, you know, out there. That part of the universe is governed by different rules, different forces, and that is what I want to talk about in this episode of Subatomic Stories. In episode 6, I told you about the known fundamental forces, specifically electromagnetism, the strong and weak nuclear forces, and gravity. Then, in that same episode, I ignored gravity entirely. Why is that? It's because our understanding of how gravity affects the world is very different from how the other three forces work. In episode 5, I sketched out how forces work in the quantum realm, but we don't yet have an accepted theory of quantum gravity. In this episode, I want to talk about gravity in the way we currently understand it. Gravity is the most familiar of the forces. We encounter it as young children, and we learn to feed ourselves, sometimes without success. It was in the 1670s when Sir Isaac Newton devised his theory of universal gravity. In his theory, the force between any two objects depends on the mass of each of the two objects and the distance between them. He even invented a simple equation that quantified his ideas. Newton's ideas are still applicable even 3.5 centuries later. For instance, NASA used Newton's law of gravity to shoot the New Horizons space probe to Pluto, traveling 3.26 billion miles over 9.5 years and hit a target 10 miles across. That's impressive. While Newton's law of gravity works in just about all familiar situations, it fails in regions of very strong gravity or for very precise measurements. That's where Albert Einstein comes in. In 1915, he released his theory of general relativity. General relativity was a very different way of looking at the universe and the nature of forces. Einstein's theory threw away the idea of forces like most of us understand them. Instead, his theory showed that what we call gravity is actually the bending and distortion of space-time. Locations with a concentrated amount of energy bend space more than ones with a low concentration of energy. And mass is a concentrated form of energy. Einstein's equation is monstrously hard to solve, but I've written it down here. We see that it's basically g with some subscripts equals t with some subscripts times a bunch of constants. The g side describes the shape of space, and the t side describes the distribution of matter and energy in space. The equal signs is key. It says that the distribution of mass and energy equals the shape of space and time, well, times some constants. A famous physicist by the name of John Wheeler summed up these equations with the phrase, space-time tells matter how to move, matter tells space-time how to curve. Now, there are people who don't believe in general relativity, but general relativity has been tested, and there's no doubt that it works very well. One prediction of general relativity is that the path that light follows should be bent by gravity, even though light has no mass. The second is that clocks in strong gravitational fields should run slower than ones in weak gravitational fields. The first impactful test of general relativity occurred in 1919 and demonstrated the ability of the sun to bend the passage of light. Sir Arthur Eddington took advantage of a solar eclipse to block the light from the sun. With the sun blocked out, he could see the stars behind it. He knew where those stars should be if relativity was or was not correct, and he saw them where they would be if Einstein was right. There have also been several tests of how the strength of gravity affects clocks, but I have a favorite. Researchers at the National Institute of Standards and Technology in Boulder, Colorado, had two extremely precise clocks, so precise that they lose about 1 second every 3.7 billion years. That's about 1 second over the lifetime of the Earth. Gravity on Earth isn't uniform. It's strongest at the surface, and it drops at higher elevations. Using these ultra-precise clocks, the researchers could raise one clock by a single foot of distance, and it ran faster than the one on the ground. This was an amazing technical accomplishment. On a more practical level, for anybody who's been lost and had their phone save them, they've got general relativity to thank. There's a constellation of satellites circling the Earth. Each satellite contains a very precise atomic clock. Together, they are called the Global Positioning System, or GPS. A receiver in your phone listens to the signal from the satellites and figures out your location with a precision of 10 feet or so. That precision depends crucially on Einstein's theory of general relativity. If you didn't take into account the effects of relativity, they'd get your location wrong. In a single day, GPS would say that you were 6 miles away from where you actually are. This is the most familiar and practical demonstration that Einstein was right. General relativity is weird, to be sure, and it's certainly counterintuitive, but it works very well. Well, except for tiny distances. But that's a story for another episode. In fact, I think this quick introduction to modern gravity is probably enough for one day. Let's see what questions our viewers had. Hi there, everyone. It's question and answer time. But before I get to that, I'd like to thank everyone who contributed a good or bad science dad joke. I promised to call out my favorite. There were many fun ones, but I ruled out any that I'd heard before. It was very hard, but my favorite one was by Brent Krynop, who told us that a tachyon is just a gluon that isn't completely dry. I like that one. A close runner-up was one by Dipsoid, who asked, which has more calories, a burger or a steak? The answer was a steak, of course, because the burger is in its ground state. Then there were a couple of jokes that, when I read, I made a face like, oh. One of them was so bad I thought it deserved special mention. Acaro Bruno asked what we call a function with a series of cat faces raised to powers. A polynomial function. That one hurt. Several people noted a few times where I made some mistakes and spoke incorrectly. Emmett O'Brien mentioned both. Yep, they happen. Sorry about that. It was mildly embarrassing, but it could have been worse. I could have said that pineapple belonged on pizza. That would have been truly embarrassing. Suyash Verma asked if neutrinos and antimatter neutrinos have no electrical charge, what's the difference? Hi, Suyash. That's a good question and harder than you think, with a series of ever deeper answers. The first answer is that neutrinos spin so that if they're coming straight at you, they appear to rotate clockwise. Antineutrinos rotate counterclockwise, and the two particles can annihilate into a Z boson. That's the quick textbook answer. Now, the more subtle answer is that only neutrinos and antimatter neutrinos with those spin patterns interact with a weak force. It's possible that there exist neutrinos and antineutrinos with opposite spin patterns, but if they exist, they don't interact via the weak force. There's another subtlety. To keep the answer short, let me talk only about neutrinos. Antineutrinos are just the opposite, but the idea is the same. Neutrinos are called left-handed particles because if you point your thumb in the direction they're moving, the fingers of your left hand wrap in the direction that neutrinos spin. And as long as neutrinos have no mass and travel at the speed of light, this is always true. However, if neutrinos have mass, then it's possible to go faster than they do. This means if I saw a neutrino moving to your left, and someone moved to the left faster than the neutrino, they'd see it moving to the right. The spin direction wouldn't change, but that would change the neutrino from a left-handed particle to a right-handed one. But a right-handed neutrino doesn't exist. Right-handed antineutrinos do. So this is complicated. In fact, we're not 100% sure that if neutrinos and antineutrinos are different or the same. If a particle and antiparticle are different, they're called Dirac particles. If they're the same, they're called Majorana. And neutrinos could be either Dirac or Majorana. So, Suyash, the bottom line is that there's still a lot to learn about neutrinos and antineutrinos. Rich Sposato asked about right-handed neutrinos and whether they are antineutrinos. Hi, Rich. So I answered some of your questions in the previous answer, but there's more. We don't know if right-handed neutrinos exist, but there is a theory that says that they do, and they're massive. Another piece of that theory suggests that they could be dark matter. The short answer is that we don't know everything, but right-handed neutrinos aren't antineutrinos. Sid Gaming asks if neutrinos can explain the matter-antimatter asymmetry. Hi, Sid. Maybe. There's a theory called leptogenesis that ties neutrinos to the asymmetry. It also requires massive right-handed neutrinos that don't interact via the weak force. I made a long-form video about leptogenesis, and the link is in the description. It seems that right-handed neutrinos have popped up in a couple of questions. They might be the subject of a future video. Frankness777 asks if massless particles experience time. Hi, Frankness. It's an interesting question with answers that can be sketchy. The answers revolve around the fact that objects without mass move at the speed of light. The equations of special relativity work for speeds slower than the speed of light and fail when they reach it. So at some level, any answer I give is based on equations that we know don't apply. However, the equations work for all speeds less than the speed of light, say at 99.99999% or something. And for those, as you go faster, time slows down and objects shrink. Accepting that trend and extending it to the speed of light, massless objects experience no time, and something as huge as the universe shrinks to having zero thickness. Accordingly, it appears that a photon crossing the universe is everywhere it runs, at least according to its perspective. Like I said, the equations fail at exactly the speed of light, but it certainly appears that massless particles experience no time and no distance. Weird. Dasit Main asks if space-time is quantized or if we assume it's smooth. That's a great question, and I'm issuing another IOU on that one. The answer is borderline philosophical. I'll answer it in an upcoming video. Peter K. asks about an incongruity. Scientists say that neutrinos can pass through 5 light-years of lead, but can only pass through 0.1 millimeter of neutron star stuff. How can they both be right? Hi, Peter. Good question, and sharp eyes. Here's the deal. Neutron stars have a density of about 10^9 kilograms per cubic meter. Lead has a density of about 10^4 kilograms per cubic meter. Neutron stars are 100,000 times denser than lead. So everything else being equal, if a neutrino can pass through 0.1 millimeter of neutron star material, it should pass through only 10 meters of lead. That all makes sense. But it neglects something. The probability of neutrino interactions depends on energy. Low-energy solar neutrinos interact far less than high-energy accelerator ones. Depending on the energies you're considering, high-energy neutrinos can interact millions or billions of times easier than low-energy ones, or even more. Bottom line, neutrino interactions depend on total amount of mass encountered and the energy of the neutrinos themselves. If you combine both effects, the Zeeman incongruity just goes away. Peter S. asks for the logic connecting electric potential and mass. He gets special points for invoking one of my favorite movies. Hi, Peter. Luckily, the connection is straightforward. Energy and electric potential are connected through the charge of a particle like a proton or electron. Take a proton and release it in a 1-volt electric field, and its energy will be 1 electron volt. Put it in a 1,000,000-volt electric field, and it will gain 1,000,000 electron volts of energy. If you're making particle accelerators using voltage, you see the obvious connection between electrical voltage and electron volts as energy units. The connection to mass is also straightforward, and it's Einstein's famous E equals mc squared. If energy has units of electron volts, then mass has units of electron volts per c squared. Since mass units of electron volts per c squared get multiplied by c squared, they cancel. Since they cancel, scientists get lazy when they talk about mass units and simply drop the per c squared thing. That's all there is to it. Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions today. There were some good ones. If you're enjoying the series, please like, subscribe, and share. I'd like to see the numbers go up. And they should go up. After all, we're talking about physics and, well, as you know, even at home, physics is everything.